सर वाले बोलते हैं।
They say all good things always do not come on time. Sometimes it is delayed because all fruits are ripened up time. And so is the today's resource person today, because we all know that release which can be granted by the court in a suit by a specific performance is always an issue which one thinks about, that you can simply, you can get anything which you are actually demanding within your mind, that you will get it. But is it actually so that, or the relief has to be claimed in a specific mode and a manner? And where there are larger issues as a professional one feels, wherein sometimes the court says that relief you have claimed cannot be given because it's not happily worded, or it has not even been worded. And sometimes specifically in 226 and 482, under the inherent powers you get when we write any other order or direction, any relief. But does that power, though not specifically conferred, or you can as such agree upon that it lies within that, but if the actually court sees from the pleading in terms of order 7, etc., what is the way forward for that? For all these issues, for a youngster or for any lawyer practicing on the civil side, or any professional for that matter, I would say this webinar would always help him to understand the issues in the right perspective. And because since we have been doing webinars pan India, and speakers are also coming from pan India, and a lot of webinars we have done with the person in charge, that is Ari Lakshmi Logomuthi of Legal Elites, Legal Elites. And just like the title of the group Eagles, she has an eye to catch up good resource persons. And for that matter, we thought that we should have the session from a resource person who is immensely popular down south. And as they say that boundaries are only in the mindset, and these virtual courts have actually shown and reflected to us that boundary knowledge has no boundaries, just like smile can win the hearts of many. Similar is the way of knowledge. Knowledge also not only wins the heart, but it also wins the mind. That is the only beauty within the smile and the knowledge, is that it wins heart and brain, whereas smile can generally win only the heart, because they say that heart is on the left, but it thinks it right. And before we ask Mr. Shankar Murali to take forward the session, our knowledge partner, Adi Lakshmi, the actual eagle of that group, to take over. I will rather say she is the eagle who can actually see from the top what is the going best overall over India. Over to you, Adi Lakshmi.
Welcome, my dear brother Vikas. Thank you so much for inviting Legal Eagles LI team to co-partner. Respected Shankar Murali sir is basically from Trichy, a very famous town down south in Tamil Nadu, and he is such a renowned person in civil jurisprudence. He has been practicing more than 3 decades, and he spends lots of time in his library. He is burnt enough of his midnight oil, and in fact, sir takes the session without taking a single penny for everyone. Wherever he goes, whichever forum, whichever college or whichever association, whichever bar he goes in, sir has a habit not to take any money which is given, whatever, if it has a little amount, if at all is given, he spends only for the people who are asking them to give it for some organization. That is magnanimous mindset, and he has such a voluminous citations with him. Whenever he comes on air, he comes with such a load of citations, and we should thank his junior Harita, who just finished his law. She has been immensely helping us in these webinars. Thank you. It is so nice to join in with Beyond Law CLC, Legal Eagles Elite, as a family is conducting. I welcome Vikas and all the participants. Sir, Shankar Murali sir, it's a great honor. I came to Chennai. Now you are going to North, and this is the first step. We are going to Pan India, so we are happy from Tamil Nadu, everyone. Thank you all from Pan India for joining in this session. I welcome every one of you.
Yes.
So just place the camera properly so that you are in the center of the frame, and then we start.
Yeah. Camera kanna konja correct a
vechirunga. Yeah, now it's fine, sir.
It's fine.
Yeah. Don't come too close, otherwise you come closer to the screen. Just push back slightly.
Okay.
That's fine.
May I proceed?
Sir, still you have come closer to the camera.
Yes, yes.
Back. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, my dear brother Vikas ji, and my dear sister Adilakshmi Logamurthy. It is my immense pleasure to deliver lecture on this topic again, and that is first time in North India, suit for specific performance through webinar. I have been taking webinar classes in Tamil Nadu only. When my brother Vikas ji invited me, I immediately accepted his offer wholeheartedly and sincerely. And I would be failing in my duty if I am not thanking Advocate Adilakshmi, who has introduced my name to Mr. Vikas ji. Except the differences between the court fees and all other things are same. And you were all well aware, a degree passed by a trial court on merits can only be set aside or reversed by the appellate court. But under Section 28 of the Specific Relief Act, a degree for specific performance passed by the court of first instance, that is a trial court on merits, it can also be set aside by the same court which has passed the degree. When the plaintiff degree holder fails to deposit the balance sale price within the time allowed in the degree. Like this, there are so many wonders under this Specific Relief Act, and let me deal with it. Now, I have divided this topic into 12 chapters, and the first chapter, number one, is concept. The specific in 63 is evolved from the well-known legal maxim, ipi jus ipi remedium, that is remedy for every right infringed. Hence, this act contemplates an adequate remedy for the right infringed. It is a remedy which aims at the exact fulfillment of an obligation. Please kindly take note down 2007 7 SEC 125. Specific relief act is an adjective law because the name itself indicate it's a specific relief, and it is a part of law of procedure. It is not a substantive law, it is a part of law of procedure, and it is a branch of estoppel. Granting a degree for specific performance is a rule. Exception, refusal is the exception. And chapter number 2, constitutional validity. You are aware under Article 300A of the Constitution of India, no person shall be deprived of his property save by authority of law. This is my property. Can the agreement holder can file a suit and take away my property against my wishes? It is not violating Article 300A of Constitution of India, because this is because the agreement is for the fulfillment of contractual obligation. But it has no impact over the right of a transferee to enforce a contract of transfer. 1992, two civil law judgment. 1992, two civil law judgment, 105, Delhi High Court. Now, third chapter, forms of pleadings. All the civil advocates are aware that each and every suit in the plaint in each and every suit must contain the legal averments which are set out in Appendix A. There are so many forms. When we refer the Appendix A in a suit for money, yes, citations 1992, two civil law judgment, page 105. Suppose.
Mr. Shankar, yes. you can keep on continuing the citation. Yes. Your associate can give it at the point on the WhatsApp later on. I will share it on the group.
Yes, Yes, yes.
Or if your associate can type it, then it's fine. But otherwise, yes, you can share the total compendium.
Yes, I will share it. I will share it.
Yeah.
So each and every in the plaint in each and every suit must contain the legal amendments as contemplated under Appendix A. For example, if you file a suit for recovery of money based on a promissory note, what would be the legal amendments that the defendant executed a promissory note after borrowing some of rupees 1 lakh as a case may be, and he has executed a promissory note in my favor, and he has unconditionally undertaking to repay the amount, both the principal and interest, on demand. Ma, audio clear alien chodan ma number. Demand. So the definition of promissory note under the Negotiable Instrument Act, the person who has borrowed money unconditionally undertakes to repay the principal amount along with the interest on demand. Suppose a suit has been filed without issuing any pre-suit notice demanding the defendant that you have already executed a promissory note in favor of my client and you have failed to not care to pay the principal and interest, you pay the amount. If any suit is filed based on the promissory note without giving any notice, can the defendant plead that the suit is premature because there is no demand? Because there is no demand. But Form A, Appendix A, Form 1 says, in a plaint in the suit for money based on the promissory note, it need not contain the averment that the defendant unconditionally undertakes to repay the amount on demand, because the filing of the plaint itself is a demand. Likewise, when we see the legal averments that may be stated in the plaint in the suit for specific performance, that is in Form 47. Form 47 in Appendix A says, the plaint in a suit for specific performance must contain the legal averments. Legal averments, that is, the plaintiff has been or still always ready and willing to perform his part of obligation. So in a suit for specific performance, when delivery of possession is sought for, the plaint must contain the legal averments that the plaintiff has been or always ready and willing to perform his part of contract. So it is in Form 47 of Appendix A. When a suit is filed by specific performance stating that in furtherance of the sale agreement, the plaintiff is inducted into possession of the property, and the suit is filed for specific performance and for permanent injunction restraining the defendant vendor from interfering with his peaceful possession and enjoyment of the suit property, then such a plaint must be in consonance with Appendix A, Form 48. Appendix A, Form 48. So each and every suit, in each and every suit, the plaint must disclose the legal averments as contemplated under Appendix A. Now, the Registration Act has been amended. Section 17(1) capital A has been inserted with the effect from 24/9/2001, wherein when the sale agreement contains a recital that the possession of the property to be conveyed is handed over, then such a sale agreement must be registered compulsorily. That is the mandate of the amended section 17(1)(a). So if a suit is filed for specific performance of the sale agreement, if it is an unregistered containing the clause that the possession of the property has already been delivered are delivered in furtherance of the sale agreement, then it must be registered. Now, the point for the consideration. advocate those who are all practicing in civil side are often confused. Registration Act says sale agreement containing delivery of personal property has to be registered compulsorily. If it is unregistered, then what is the legal effect? Can it be marked as an evidence? So while inserting section 17(1)(a) suitably section 49 of the Registration Act and section 52 of the 53A of the Transfer of Property Act has also been amended. So they cannot ask for part performance. They are part performance when the sale agreement is unregistered. If a suit is filed on the basis of the sale agreement, which is unregistered, containing a delivery of possession, then a degree for specific performance alone can be granted, and the relief of permanent injunction restraining the defendant mentor from interfering with his possession and enjoyment cannot be granted. This is the for this I would like to rely upon 2012-3 CTC Madras page 205 division bench. Now in our state Tamil Nadu, the Tamil Nadu government has also amended the Registration Act, and on and from 1/12/2012 all sale agreement have to be registered compulsorily. Registration is compulsory whether or not delivery of the person of the property is given or not. So after 1/12/2012 all sale agreements have to be registered compulsorily. I don't know whether in Punjab and Haryana similar amendment was made, but unfortunately section 49 of the Registration Act has not been amended. Section 49 deals with effect of non-registration of document which requires compulsory registration. So after the advent of the Tamil Nadu Amendment Act, all sale agreements have to be registered. If the sale agreement is not registered, can it be received in evidence? Can it be received in evidence? That is the point. Since section 49 has not been amended, section 49 of the Registration Act says in a suit for specific performance, the sale agreement can be received in evidence. So even though stated that the sale agreement has to be registered compulsorily, in and by virtue of the non-amendment of section 49, an unregistered sale agreement can be admitted in evidence, a degree for specific performance can also be granted. This is 2008-1 Tamil Nadu Civil Judgment, page 771. In a recent judgment, our Honorable Supreme Court, in Prakash Shagu versus Salal and others, this is delivered on 2/9/2019. The Honorable High Court dismissed the suit on the ground that the suit sale agreement is an unregistered one since it requires compulsory registration. Setting aside the order of the High Court, the Supreme Court said, in so far as section 49 of the Registration, the unregistered sale agreement can be received in evidence, a degree for specific performance can be granted. Now, suppose a sale deed was executed. It was duly executed, attested, but it has not been registered. So based on the unregistered sale deed, I'm talking about sale deed, not sale agreement. Unregistered sale deed, whether it can be received in evidence, whether it can be looked into, if, for what purpose? unregistered sale deed can also be received in evidence for the purpose of proving the collateral transaction, that is the existence of the sale agreement between the parties. This is 2010 4 MLJ 529 Supreme Court. This is a decision of our Supreme Court, 2010 4 MLJ page 529, and it has also been followed in our Tamil Nadu High Court, in Madras High Court, 2014 1 CTC page 447. So you please keep it in mind, the plaint in a suit for specific performance must be in consonance with the form A of degree for specific performance alone can be granted, and then the degree in a suit for specific performance the degree must contain that the suit is degree, the plaintiff is direct normally 2 months. The court will also add that defendant as per nature of preliminary degree. Performance, but it assumes the character of a preliminary degree. Contacts. Court within a stipulated time fails to deposit the same, then under section 28 of the Specific Relief Act, is a degree holder. Degree holder means is something different. Granted in favor of A. So they can also execute a degree. And the degree is assigned, the assignee can also execute the degree. Degree in the person in whose favor the degree is passed. But once a degree for specific performance is granted, who is the degree holder? We can immediately say that is the plaintiff. Certainly not. Both the plaintiff and because the plaintiff deposits the balance sale price into time, then he can execute the degree. Under those circumstances, he is a degree holder. Suppose the the defendant before the expired time, the plaintiff may be directed to deposit the balance sale price. Then under those circumstances, the defendant a direction to the plaintiff to deposit the balance sale price to be affixed the court fee payable is on the the court fees in a suit for specific performance is 3% on the total sale price. Article 54 of the Limitation Act gives the answer. Article 54 the party after the expiry of such period from the date within a period of 3 years the suit has to be filed for specific performance. So first limb says when no date is fixed that how to reckon the period. Limitation commences when the plaintiff notice has to issue statutory notice expressing his readiness and willingness to purchase the defendant after the receipt of this notice from the plaintiff refuses to execute sale deed or deny the execution of the sale deed and sale agreement whatever it may be then that he has noticed that the performance refused by his adversary then from the date 3 years period is contemplated under the second limb of Article 54 of Limitation Act. Normally, first limb says 3 years period. Normally, we will issue a notice within the stipulated time. Suppose the sale agreement contains that from the date of execution of the sale agreement, the balance sale price has to be paid within a period given, and the defendant may or may not say 3 years. Whether such practice is correct. Your suit may be well within time, there's no doubt about it. Your suit will not be dismissed on the ground of limitation. But in a suit for specific performance, the plaintiff must be ready and willing to perform his part of obligation from the day one, that is from the date of execution of the sale agreement. If any delay is caused in filing the suit for specific performance, then it affects your suit. Because delay defeats equity. Equity favors a vigilant and not an indolent litigant. Now, as per the amended act, there is no discretionary power vested with the court either to grant a degree for specific performance or not. But equity aids the vigilant and not the indolent. Immediately, you must file a suit for specific performance without any delay. This has been held in Municipal Council, Ahmed Nagar versus Shah Haider Bey, 2000, year 2000, volume 2, SEC, page 48. So there cannot be any delay, latches on the part of the plaintiff in bringing the suit for specific performance. And next, and very interesting chapter is readiness and willingness. What it means, what it refers. Just now I said, as per Appendix A, Form 47, the plaintiff in a suit for specific performance must plead, must aver that he has been or still ready and willing to perform this part of contract. All right. There are two phraseology, readiness and willingness. Readiness means the capacity of the plaintiff to pay the balance sale price. That is, the plaintiff must prove that he is having sufficient financial resources to pay the balance sale price. That is his readiness. Willingness, this phraseology is referable to the conduct of the plaintiff. Conduct in strict sense here means unblemished conduct. What it means? The plaintiff conduct from the date of execution of the sale agreement, whether he has performed his part of obligation in time, whether he has filed the suit without any delay, whether he is very much interested in buying the property, all these things have to be considered by the court. So the willingness is a term referred to the conduct of the plaintiff. Before the amendment made in the Specific Relief Act 2018, under Section 16, the plaintiff who fails to aver is not entitled to get a specific degree for specific performance. Proof is not necessary, but the act has been amended. Section 16C, the word aver is deleted. The word prove is inserted. Who fails to prove his readiness and willingness is not entitled to get a degree for specific performance. Because this is a personal bar to grant a degree for specific performance. This is a personal bar. And explanation 2 to section 16C also. The person who failed to prove his readiness and willingness is not entitled to get a degree for specific performance. So, to get a degree for specific performance, the plaintiff in an action must satisfy the court that he is always ready and willing. The terms readiness and willingness are having nexus with each other. It is inseparable. Proof of both would empower you to get a degree for specific performance. Proof of one is not sufficient. It will not entitle you to get a degree for specific performance. In other words, the readiness is nothing but a wagon containing gold coin. The wagon containing gold coin has to reach its destination. How? Only by cart. The cart is the willingness. Only by the cart, the wagon containing the gold coin can reach its destination. This has been held in 2016, 4 CTC, page 470, Madras. 2016, 4 CTC, page 470. And another important thing, we have come across in so many cases, the sale agreement contains that the sale price fixed is 1 lakh. On the date of execution of the sale agreement, the purchaser has paid a sum of rupees 90,000 towards advance. And he has agreed to pay the balance sale price of 10,000 within a period of 1 year or 2 years. If this kind of sale agreement is precedent to service in a suit for specific performance, without any hesitation, without any reservation, the court may come to a conclusion that the transaction that transpired between the plaintiff and defendant must be a loan transaction and not a sale transaction. Then the court can simply dismiss the suit for specific performance. It can dismiss the suit. This is held in Papamal versus P. Ramaswamy, 2012, 4 CTC, page 100. Our apex court has elaborately discussed the terms readiness and willingness. The terms readiness and willingness. In the case reported in His Holiness Acharya Swami Ganesh versus Sitaram Thapar, 1996. 4 ACC 526, when the plaintiff be able to establish that he is having sufficient funds to pay the balance sale price, but at the same time he has failed to prove his conduct. If the suit is filed with delay, if the suit is filed with latches, and there are some inordinate delay and procrastination, unreasonable delay, court will not grant a degree for specific performance. The plaintiff conduct is unblemished. He has issued a notice in time, he has filed a suit in time, but he is not able to prove his financial resources. Then no degree can be granted. Now the amended act says you have to prove your readiness and willingness. Then how to prove my readiness in a suit for specific performance? The plaintiff can file his income tax return stating that he is paying income tax every year like this. And he can also file his bank statement to show that he is having sufficient balance in his account to pay the balance sale price. Or he may examine any one of his friends or relatives to prove that they are ready to help them financially. Help the plaintiff financially to pay the balance sale price as and when request is made. So these are all some sort of evidences to prove the plaintiff's readiness. But the plaintiff's conduct can only be determined by his own act, that is, proper notice within the time stipulated in the sale agreement and the filing of the suit, not in time, immediately when the plaintiff noticed that his performance is refused. Annulli is entitled to get a degree for specific performance. So, when the plaintiff has not pleaded that he is ready and willing to perform this part of contract, no degree for specific performance can be granted. 2019 3 CTC page 564 Madras Division Bench. Then I will come to that later regarding the burden of proof. Suppose before filing the suit for specific performance by the plaintiff, if the property agreed to be conveyed in favor of the plaintiff is sold by the vendor in favor of the third party, a subsequent purchaser, if the suit is in an action by the plaintiff for specific performance, if the vendor remained ex parte, then the subsequent purchaser can raise a plea that the plaintiff is not ready, that the plaintiff is not willing to perform his part of contract. So this is Supreme Court decision reported in AIR 2009 Supreme Court page 2157. Then very important in a suit for specific performance, whether the sale agreement can be assigned or transferred, whether the transferee or representative in interest are assigned of the agreement holder can maintain a suit for specific performance. Suppose A enters into a sale agreement with B and he has paid some amount as advance and agreed to pay the balance sale price. Before the expiry of that period, he has transferred his right in favor of his friend C. Can C straight away file a suit for specific performance against B when there is no privity of contract between B and C initially? Whether the sale agreement can be assigned? The answer lies under section 15B of the Specific Relief Act. Who may obtain a degree for specific performance? Party to the agreement or representative in interest or principal of either party. So a nominee or assigned can very well maintain a suit for specific performance against the vendor, provided when the sale agreement specifically contains a recital that the interest herein created cannot be transferred or assigned, then under those circumstances, the sale agreement cannot be transferred or assigned. So in the absence of such recital in the sale agreement, the transferee or assigned can very well maintain a suit for specific performance. This is a very rare judgment. Please kindly take note of it. AIR 2004 Supreme Court page 343. Normally what the civil advocates are doing is, for filing a suit for specific performance, it's a cumbersome process. Notice have to be sent, readiness and willingness have to be established, and the court fees have to be paid. Instead of filing a suit for specific performance, straight away they will file a suit for injunction, restraining the vendor from alienating or encumbering the property. Whether such a suit for permanent injunction restraining your vendor from alienating or encumbering the property is maintainable? Certainly it is not maintainable. Because when an injunction cannot be granted, Section 41, subclass H of the Specific Relief Act, when an efficacious remedy can be obtained by the plaintiff, he is not entitled to get a degree for injunction. So on the date of filing of the suit for injunction, the plaintiff has got right to file a suit for specific performance. He can very well obtain his efficacious remedy for specific performance. Instead of filing a suit for specific performance, if injunction suit simpliciter is filed, the suit is not maintainable. The suit is not maintainable. Even if you obtained a permission under Order 2, Rule 3 of CPC. But each and every case goes on its own merits. This is reported in 2020. That gentleman, 2020. 5 CTC, page 435. 2020, 5 CTC, page 435. Now, there are cases. The defendant, the vendor, after receiving the entire sale consideration, execute a sale deed, and he will be called upon by the purchaser to come to registrar office for registration. Suppose the vendor has not come to the registrar office to register the sale deed. He has already, sale deed was prepared, it was typed on the non-judicial stamp paper, it was duly executed by the vendor, it has also been duly witnessed. But the vendor refuses to come to registrar office to register the document. Then what is the remedy available to the purchaser? Then what is the remedy available to the purchaser? Whether he can be compelled to file a suit for specific purpose? Because sale deed has already been executed, but provided it has not been registered. The answer is under section 77 of the Registration Act. When the executant refuses to come to registrar office or denies the execution, the registrar may refuse to register the document. Then the purchaser may institute a suit for registration of the document already executed. The prayer is for registration of the sale deed already executed by the defendant only. It is a lesser relief provided under the Registration Act. But the larger relief is provided under the Specific Relief Act. You can also buy the suit for specific performance. Compelling the defendant to execute a registered sale deed in your favor. But this is section 77 says, but for only for limited purpose of registration of the sale deed alone. So this is references 1982. 1982, 2 MLJ, page 41. Yellammal versus Rangasami counter. Yellammal versus Rangasami counter. And another one is 1991, 1 MLJ, page 22, Madras. 1991, 1 MLJ, page 22, Madras. Periyasami counter versus Chinnasami counter. Then another important aspect, whether the deposit of the balance sale price into court is a condition precedent to institute a suit for specific performance. Whether the plaintiff can be compelled to deposit the balance sale consideration into the court at the time of presenting his plaint for specific performance. Section 16 of Specific Relief Act says, unless and otherwise the court directs the plaintiff to deposit the balance sale price into court, the plaintiff need not jingle his coin. He need not deposit the balance sale price into court. This is a division bench of our Bombay High Court. AIR 2009, Notes of Cases, Bombay, Division Bench, page 1054. AV Deal Tools and Services versus Tuft Fasteners Private Limited. And in some cases, the sale agreement may contain that we hereby enter into the sale agreement. I agree to buy the property on this total sale price of so and so, and the vendor is hereby agreed to obtain income tax certificate from the income tax department or obtain clearance certificate from the land selling department. If conditions are imposed in the sale agreement, it is not the duty of the court to supervise whether the degree for specific performance can be granted on condition. So suit for specific degree, a suit for specific performance must be simple. That's all. When a degree is passed, then it is the duty of the defendant to execute the sale deed in favor of the plaintiff. If any conditions is imposed, that you must obtain income tax certificate and you must get clearance from the sealing department, no degree can be passed. So degree for specific performance on condition cannot be passed. This is 1999. Three Law Weekly, page 249, full bench, Madras High Court. In that case, the property of the vendor was taken over by the government under the Urban Land Sealing Act. Thereafter, the vendor entered into a sale agreement, stating that he is taking steps to recover the property from the government. And the court said, the agreement is against the public policy, public morality, as contemplated under Section 23 of the Contract Act. The court cannot grant a degree for specific performance on condition that as and when the government return the property to the defendant, he has to execute the sale in favor of the plaintiff. So no condition can be imposed while granting a degree for specific performance. And in some cases, A enter into a sale agreement with B on the failure of the B to execute the sale deed, A filed a suit for specific performance. In that suit, some C filed an impeding application stating that he is the owner of the property, he is the title holder of the property, B has no title to the property, so he is a necessary party. Whether such impeding application can be allowed? Whether such impeding application can be allowed? Supreme Court said the impeding application has to be dismissed. If it is allowed, then the suit for specific performance will be converted into a title suit. So if any degree is passed, not against a true owner, then it will not bind him. So he is not a necessary party. Now the latest decision of the Supreme Court by the decision rendered by Justice Ravindran S.K. then was, I think in Mumbai International Case 2010 SEC. Lordship has categorically held, plaintiff is the dominant status. He cannot be compelled to impede term, take and carry as his opponent against his wishes. It is for the plaintiff to choose his opponent. How the court can compel, you must impede some A, B or A, C. Suppose if any application is filed to impede the proposed party as a necessary party, if it is objected to by the plaintiff, the court has to simply dismiss the application, provided at the time of trial, if the court comes to the conclusion that so-and-so is the necessary party, then court may simply dismiss the suit on the ground of non-joinder of necessary party under Order 1 Rule 9. So, just to minimize the work. So, if a person claiming title or better title, if he filed an application to implicate him as a party in the suit instituted by the purchaser against the person who has entered into sale agreement, he is not a necessary party. This is Kasturi versus I.M. Barmal. Kasturi versus I.M. Barmal, 2005, 6 SEC, page 733. Then coming to the relief which can be granted by the court in a suit for specific performance. The first which I would like to share with you is section 12 of the Specific Relief Act. Specific performance of part of contract. Specific performance of part of contract. I will give one illustration. 1 acre of land is agreed to build by the vendor in favor of the purchaser. Agreement was entered into, registered, everything is over. But after the execution of the sale agreement, suppose a major portion, say for example, more than 50%, 50 cents or 60 cents, 75 cents, is acquired by the government to widen the road for highways and whatever purpose, or if for any public purpose, then can the purchaser bring a suit for specific performance and claim in respect of entire 1 acre has to be executed in his favor? That is why, under those circumstances, where a party to contract is unable to perform the whole of his part, but the part which must be left unperformed bears only a small portion, So only in respect of the small portion, a degree for specific performance can be granted. That is in respect of 20 patients. If 20 patients is already acquired already by the government, then the remaining 20 patients can very well be, the degree for specific performance can be granted in respect of the remaining small portion. This is AIR 2006, Uttaranchal, page 76. AIR 2006, Uttaranchal, page 76. But you think otherwise. One acre of land has been agreed to be sold. Government has acquired only 25 cents. The remaining portion is 75 cents. Then section 12 says not to grant a degree for specific performance because he has already suffered by the action of the government. So if the portion of the contract left unperformed is considerable part of the whole, and for that portion compensation would be determined in terms of money, specific performance shall not be ordered. This is your High Court, Punjab and Haryana, AIR 2004, Punjab and Haryana, page 178. AIR 2004, Punjab and Haryana, page 178. When there are so many sharers, in respect of the joint family property, when any one of the sharer enter into an agreement of sale stating that there are four sharers including himself, and he enter into the sale agreement for himself on behalf of other sharers, and he has agreed to procure the consent and the signature of the other sharers, if any such sale agreement is entered into, and if a suit for specific performance is filed on the basis of the said sale agreement, and the other sharers denied the authority of the sharer who has entered into sale agreement, the court can degree a suit for specific performance in respect of the share of the sharer who has entered into sale agreement. In respect of the property of other co-sharers, there cannot be any degree for specific performance. This is the decision of our Supreme Court, reported in 2005, 5 SEC, page 142. 2005, 5 SEC, page 142. In some cases, Karta enters into a sale agreement to sell the co-partnery property for the welfare of the family. On the refusal by the Karta to execute sale agreement, sale deed, then if any suit is filed for specific performance of the sale agreement executed by the Karta, including the other members of the co-partnery, if they plead that the sale agreement executed by the Karta is not for the welfare of the joint family, then the court can only grant a degree for specific performance in respect of the share of the Karta and not in respect of the entire extent of the property of the joint family. This one is reported in 2001 ISCC, page 396. 2001 ISCC, page 396. Then coming to suit for specific performance against the vendor and the subsequent purchase. If the suit is filed for specific performance, no doubt the burden of proof is on the plaintiff to prove his case. He has to prove his case only on his own strength. He cannot abandon his right and fall back upon the case of his opponent. That is well nigh principles of law. But in a suit for specific performance against the vendor and the subsequent purchaser, the burden of proof is not on the plaintiff, it is on the subsequent purchaser under section 19 of the Specific Relief Act. A entered into sale agreement with B. He has already issued a notice. A already issued a notice expressing his readiness and willingness to purchase the property. Before filing the suit for specific performance, if the property agreed to be conveyed in favor of A is sold by the B in favor of C, the subsequent purchaser, the purchaser, the A, can very well maintain a suit for specific performance not only against B, his vendor, and also against the subsequent purchaser C. If such a suit is filed, then the burden of proof is on the subsequent purchaser. The subsequent purchaser has to satisfy the court for the purpose of dismissing the suit filed by specific performance. He has to satisfy the court. Number one, he has purchased the property without knowing the existence of the suit sale agreement between A and B. So he must plead that he is not aware of the sale agreement between A and B, number one. Number two, he has paid the entire sale consideration on the date of execution of the sale deed. You please keep it in mind, he must prove that he has paid the entire sale consideration on the date of the execution of the sale deed. Here, I would like to remember you whether sale consideration must be paid only on the date of the execution of the sale deed. You please refer section 54 of the Transfer of Property Act. It says the consideration may be past, consideration may be present, and consideration may be future. So the payment of sale consideration need not be at the time of execution of the sale deed. It may be past or future. But here, the subsequent purchaser has to prove that he has paid the entire sale price. So this is an exception to section 54 of the TPI. So first one, he has to prove that he is not aware of the existence of the sale agreement between his vendor and the agreement holder plaintiff. Number two, he has paid the entire sale price on the date of execution of the sale deed in his favor. Third one, he has purchased the property in good faith. He has purchased the property in good faith. So only on satisfaction and subjective satisfaction of all these three ingredients, by the subsequent purchaser, he can effectively resist the suit filed by plaintiff for specific performance. Then this no degree can be granted. Now, here I would like to explain the word good faith, what it means. Then how to prove that he has purchased the property in good faith. when we look into the other enactments, Section 52 of Indian Penal Code defines good faith. Section 2H of the Limitation Act defines good faith. Section 3, subclass 22 of the General Taxes Act defines good faith means an act done bona fidely, whether or not done diligently or not. So there must be some bona fide. Then, what is the remedy available to the plaintiff to non-suit the subsequent purchaser? Then how the plaintiff can overcome these pleas? Then the plaintiff has to prove that the subsequent purchaser is well aware of the existence of the sale agreement. After knowing the same, he has purchased the property. He has not purchased the property, he has purchased litigation. Then how the plaintiff can prove that the subsequent purchaser is aware of the existence of the sale agreement? He may cause paper publication in this regard before filing a suit for specific performance.
So you can have water rather than
may I take only just 5 minutes?
No issues. Okay. You can have water.
You can impute the constructive notice on the part of the subsequent purchaser. If any paper publication is caused before filing the suit for specific performance by the plaintiff, in spite of the same, if any sale deed is executed in favor of the subsequent purchaser, then he cannot plead the ignorance of the existence of the sale agreement, because whether or not he has seen the paper publication or not, the plea of constructive notice will apply. In some cases, a mere sale deed alone will be executed. A mere sale deed alone is executed, even without delivering the possession of the property agreed to be sold. So no ordinary prudent man would pay amount and get the sale deed in his favor without getting the property, without getting the possession, without taking delivery of the property. Suppose the property is under the possession of the plaintiff, who has obtained the possession in furtherance of the sale agreement. Ignoring the same, if any sale is executed, then the plaintiff in an action can plead that he is in possession of the property. These are all the documents to show that, to prove his possession. So the subsequent purchaser has simply obtained only a sale deed, registered sale deed, that's all. He has not taken delivery of the property. Then there is a question of bona fide on his part. So you can restrict, you can resist. And the payment of entire sale consideration, normally in the sale deed, I paid a sum of so and so sum of rupees towards the sale price, and you have already received the sale. So the payment must be now either by way of check, DD, or now by the RTGS. in left, whatever it may. Because now two, I think section 296 of Income Tax Act, when the value exceeds 20,000, then all the transaction must be only by way of check. So you can attack. No sale consideration was paid by the subsequent purchaser. There is no proof to show that he has paid the entire sale price. You cannot search any citation in this regard. This is my rich experience in practicing civil side. It will be very useful to you. So the subsequent purchaser can resist the suit for specific performance by saying that he has purchased the property in good faith, paid the entire sale consideration, and without knowing the existence of the sale agreement. At the same time, defendant can also resist the pleas of subsequent purchaser by proving that there is no payment of entire sale consideration, that he is having constructive notice regarding the existence of the sale agreement, other things. So the burden of proof, the advocates practicing in civil side are often committing mistake in a suit for specific performance filed by the plaintiff against his vendor and subsequent purchaser. They are producing a proof out of the plaintiff. They have start. They have commenced the trial. Don't do that. If it is a suit for specific performance against the subsequent purchaser, you rely upon section 19 and ask the court, the burden of proof is on the subsequent purchaser, letting him file his proof out of it as PW1, letting him establish case, you can defend it. So so this is the that 13th chapter, and the last one is a rescission of degree for specific performance. Most of the advocates practicing in civil side are committing mistake. After getting a degree for specific performance, straight away they have levied a degree in execution by filing execution petition for the execution of the sale deed and for taking delivery of the property. Is it correct? Once a degree for specific performance is granted, I already reiterated, it is assumes the character of a preliminary degree. So there will be direction to the plaintiff to deposit the balance sale price into the court in terms of Order 20, Rule 12A of CPC. If the plaintiff degree holder fails to deposit the balance sale price into court within the time stipulated under the degree or within the time extended by the court, then the defendant, judgment debtor, may take out an application under Section 28 of the Specific Relief Act before the trial court itself. Before the trial court itself, and he can ask for rescission of the degree on satisfaction that the defendant failed to deposit the balance sale price into court as mandated under the degree. Then the degree for specific performance will be rescinded by the trial court. You need not go to the execution court. Suppose the degree is rescinded, Section 28 further states, if the degree holder is already placed into possession, he has to re-deliver the possession of the property. He has to restore the possession to the Vendor, if any rent or profit is received by the degree holder, he is bound to return the same. All right. Then suppose the plaintiff paid the balance sale price or deposit the same into court as per the degree, then what are all the remedies that can be granted to the plaintiff degree holder? So after depositing the sale price, the balance sale price, the degree holder, the plaintiff, is entitled to file an application before the court of first instance, that is before the trial court itself. He can file an application under section 28 asking the court for the execution of the sale deed in his favor. For the execution of the sale deed in his favor. And he can also pray for delivery of possession of the property in his favor. And he can also ask for partition of the property. Say, for example, I already cited some citations. If one of the co-sharers entered into a sale agreement and his share alone is decreed in favor of the plaintiff, after getting a degree for specific performance in respect of a particular share of the defendant, and after the payment of the balance sale price into court, he can file an application under section 28 of the Specific Relief Act asking the court to partition the property and cause separate possession of the share of the defendant in his favor as against the other co-share. So for getting this relief for execution of sale deed, partition and separate possession and the delivery of possession of the property, no separate suit is necessary. No separate suit is necessary. You need not levy the degree in execution before the executing court, because the court which passes the degree retains its powers to grant the relief of execution of the sale deed, delivery of possession of the property, and the partition of the property in favor of the plaintiff who has succeeded. Unfortunately, we are committing mistake by filing execution petition. It is very pertinent. Getting an order from the execution court is not so easy. It's a very, very, very cumbersome process. There are lots of checks and balance. Order 21, Rule 1 to 106. There are so many applications. It is very easy to get a degree, but at the same time, it is very, very difficult to execute a degree. So, please keep in mind, after getting a degree for specific performance, I request you not to file execution petition. File an application under section 28 of the Specific Relief Act. Ask the court to grant to execute a sale in your favor. Ask the court to pass a delivery order. Ask the court if the degree is for in respect of one of the share, then ask the court for partition of the property and for separate possession. This is AIR 1994, Supreme Court, page 1699. AIR 1994, Supreme Court, page 1699. AIR 2007, Notes of Cases, page 70, Kerala High Court. AIR 1994, Supreme Court, 1699. Raman Kutti Kutta versus Avara. AIR 2007, Notes of Cases, page 70, Kerala High Court. Bhatma Raja versus E. Sanjeev. Now, degree for specific performance is granted. All right. Suppose the court directs the plaintiff to deposit the balance sale price into court within 2 months. Say, for example, plaintiff is not in a position to pay the balance sale price within 2 months. Then immediately you file an application for extension of time, seeking leave or permission of the court to extend the period for another 2 months so as to facilitate him to pay the balance sale price into court. Whether court can grant permission immediately? What is the basic or rudimentary principles in establishing the plaintiff's right to get a specific performance degree? He must prove that he is possessing sufficient funds to pay the balance sale price. When an application is taken out seeking extension of time to pay the balance sale price, it implies that he has no funds to pay the balance. You may say at the time of trial he has proved his financial status, but after the degree, so that must be handled by the court very reluctantly. Before ordering permission to extend the time, court must exercise its power sparingly. Suppose in some cases the degree may say that the defendant plaintiff has to deposit the balance sale price within 2 months. The plaintiff in some cases, even without filing an application for extension of time, straight away they will deposit the amount into execution court or before the trial court and file an application for execution of the sale. Then the Supreme Court said the deposit of balance sale price must be within the stipulated time or within the extended time passed by the court. If no application is filed, if any such deposit is made, dismiss the petition, dismiss the execution petition, don't execute the sale deed, don't order delivery of property. U.S. Palanichami Chettiar versus Alagappan, AIR 1999, Supreme Court, page 918. U.S. Palanichami Chettiar versus Alagappan, AIR 1999, Supreme Court, page 918. So, I hope my lecture covers the reliefs which can be granted by the court in a suit for specific performance. I hope all the participants would appreciate my efforts. And if any mistake in the course of my argument, in my course of my lecture is there, please excuse me. And I have taken my sincere efforts to cite the Supreme Court cases. But sometimes I used to cite our High Court judgments. Next time I will try to get the citations of our Punjab and Haryana High Court. And with this, I may conclude this session, Mr. Vikas Ji and Adi Lakshmi Madam.
Yeah, unmute Adi Lakshmi.
Adi Lakshmi Madam, please unmute.
Yeah, yeah, we are asking her to unmute, yeah.
Yes, Vikas Ji.
So, I'm concluding these sessions now.
Yeah. Mr. Shankar,
if any participants are having any doubts or they have any questions, they may post it in the chat box and I'll open it and I will answer.
That's true. They can even ask for the unmuting. We can unmute them also.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Chat box is open.
Whatever one could have thought of any relief or whatever one could have contemplated could have been discussed. You have discussed actually that. And since you were saying that next time you will contemplate to have the judgments of Punjab Haryana, I would say that we have the audience,
not only
from Punjab Haryana, we also have participants on our WhatsApp group from Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh. Oh. So sometimes yeah. I also feel that I never knew that they also have the same provisions. So then they say, because once we read the 9-2 code, etc., then I used to see, then they say we are from Sri Lanka and we are from Madras, but we have shifted to our studies in Sri Lanka, etc. So there are
Sri Lanka is that's specifically by more or less like that our Indian act.
A lot of people from Pakistan also do join. Not
the common,
majority, I can say
all Commonwealth countries are having very same act.
Yeah. So Pan India, we have the audience.
Yes.
So even if your judgments are there, it may not be binding upon the other high courts, but at least it has a pervasive value. That is the law.
The judgment rendered by one high court will also bind the other high court, because the point is only on the law laid down by the high court.
But sometimes the correct proportion of law
is analyzed by the high court. If any decision is rendered, then it can be followed. That, of course, under Article 141, law laid in with the Supreme Court will bind to the subordinate judiciary, including the High Court. But at the same time, doesn't mean that the judgment entered by the one High Court will not bind to the other High Court, unless some changes are there made in the particular act.
No, but normally the courts say, if they want to differ, they would say that in case of the same High Court, it is binding or you refer to a larger bench. But for the other High Courts, it is a pervasive value. It may not bind in the fashion in the same judgment of that High Court.
Next time, I will try to quote the only Supreme Court decisions.
Yeah. All judgments are good, as long as it's a knowledge. Actually,
yes.
Even if it is from the different high court, you get a path from where you can move forward for your drafting, for your arguments. That's the way I've always thought about.
Okay.
So I'm just seeing as to whether we have any questions.
Okay.
Yes. Siri Nawaz, what is the difference between a part performance and specific performance?
Yes. Part performance is defined under Section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act. Suppose on the date of execution of the sale agreement or in furtherance of the sale agreement, if the purchaser is placed in possession of the property, then his remedy is to file a suit for specific performance. To get a degree for specific performance, get a sale deed registered in his favor, take KL sale in his favor. Suppose the time to file a suit for specific performance is barred, but still he is in possession of the property. Can he get an order of injunction restraining the vendor from interfering with his possession and enjoyment of the property? This is otherwise known as part performance. No doubt, the purchaser in possession of the property in furtherance of the sale agreement can very well maintain a suit for injunction despite the fact that his right to get a degree for specific performance is barred by limitation. But when we see the section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act closely, we will understand before getting the benefit of part performance, the purchaser who wants to avail the benefit must establish that he has been, is, are always ready and willing to perform this part of contract. These are all some extraneous circumstances under which he was not in a position to get a degree for specific performance. Unless and until he established his readiness and willingness, even if he is in possession of the property, the benefit of 53A cannot be granted in his favor. So part performance he can resist, not only as a shield and as well as a sword against the vendor, provided he must establish that he was ready and willing to perform this part of obligation, but the breach is only on the part of the vendor. Then only he is entitled to get the benefit of part performance. Now this section 17(1)(a) of Registration Act has been amended, whereby in a suit for specific performance, when the sale agreement contains a delivery of the property, it must be registered compulsorily. If it is not registered, you cannot get the benefit of 53A. That is the very object of the amendment. Because not only is amendment was made in the, not only new section was inserted by under section 17(1) subclass A, but section 49 of Registration Act has also been amended. 53A is deleted. And 53A of TPAD has also been amended to that effect. So, for the purpose of getting the benefit of 53A, you must establish that your sale agreement is registered. You must establish that you are ready and willing to perform your part of contract. And even though the time to file the suit for specific performance is barred by a flux of time, since you are in possession of indemnity property, you can very well resist the vendor from interfering with your possession and enjoyment of the property. You can safeguard your possession. Next.
Murugan, how to approach the execution proceedings in Specific Relief Act? Whether Section 28 of Specific Relief Act is sufficient?
Yes, certainly. Certainly. Section 28 of the Specific Relief Act, it gives enormous power on the court of first instance to grant the relief of execution of document, sale deed, to grant the delivery of possession, just to go through it, read it, and also for partition. So the delivery is ordered, directing the defendant to execute the degree, to deliver the possession of the property, then you may levy the degree in execution. But normally, once delivery is ordered, you can very well file an application because you need not file execution petition. You can also file an application before the trial court. You can take assistance of the police, right? And you can also ask the court to implement the order. No execution petition is necessary. Section 28 of Specific Relief Act gives enormous power on the trial court to grant the relief. No separate suit is the word employed is. No separate suit for getting the relief mentioned under section 28 is not necessary. Next.
Gopi, if seeking partition under section 28 of Specific Relief Act, what is the court fees as such?
Yes. Now, you have filed a suit for specific performance against the person who has entered the sale agreement in respect of his share. Suppose degree for specific performance is granted, then you have to file an application for partition separate possession. So under the application filed under section 28, you have to pay court fees for the partition. Now it is 5,000 rupees according to our Tamil Nadu court which amendment made in the Tamil Nadu court which include valuation, provided you are in joint possession of the property. You are not in joint possession of the property. The joint possession means your vendor. Your vendor is in joint possession. Then you have to pay court fees that you are also deemed to be, because you are stepped into the shoes of your vendor. So you may pay court fees of rupees 5,000 and get the order for partition separate possession. This is very rare. Normally nobody will do this, but section is there. We are not using that section. That is our problem.
No, we don't have any questions. Before we part for the day, I will say Adilakshmi ma'am will share her insights, and then we will conclude for the day.
Thank you so much, sir. In fact, we know Shankar Murli sir for a very long time, and usually we used to have a bilingual session speaking in our mother tongue Tamil. This is a new thing, sir, taking the session all through in English, but he did a very good, excellent job. And we all know sir is an encyclopedia in civil jurisprudence there. Down south, anything we can ask sir, you can explain us. Thank you so much, sir, for coming in. And it was a very excellent session. That too, he has entered into a new office. Usually his office was a different office. So he has to, I think he has to set right his office. There were some echoes or outside noises coming in. There was a little bit on the chat box I could see. Maybe when we have the next session, everything will be all getting cleared. We should thank his little junior Harita for getting us all the citations.
See, it's already gone.
But we thank Harita, sir. You can tell she has to leave, yes. Sir. She's Harita stays 30 kilometers away from the place she works in. So she's traveling so long as a young girl because of the passion for the profession she has. Thank you so much, Beyond Law CLC, and my dear brother Vikas, for connecting North and South continuously, East and West, everything, all parts of India getting connected in Vikas, this platform on Zoom.
Yeah, he is a bridge between South and North.
Yeah, almost all over India. Now I come to know he has people from Bangladesh, Pakistan.
Yes.
And he's the right ambassador for India for all the states. Maybe everything gets easy, going easy. On behalf of everyone here, I thank Shankar Murli sir, and because I thank the team Legal Eagles Elite and the family of Legal Eagles Elite was helping us in posting all the citations, Srinivasan, Annie, and every Shankari and everyone. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you all. Because of Shankar sir, we have traveled till north, and we have few more speakers on the line. We will be coming up. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, Vikas.
Thank you. Before we part for the day, as Adilakshmi ma'am said, it was an. She said that you are an encyclopedia, and she said that it was for the first time that you were speaking not in bilingual but English. But I would just cut her short that
she
once
is she is exaggerated.
No, I say that once if a person is an encyclopedia, then he can play at ease with everything. I'm reminded David Warner can play with left and right ease with and cricket anyway. So same way, you can't say that he cannot play straight or he cannot play with the left hand. So once who is a good speaker and who's having immense knowledge, for him, it is his choice of words, his command over the subject is what it matters. And ultimately, he can always speak on the language on what he wants to convey. And as everyone was saying that, kindly connect with Mr. Shankar Murli, the session would be amazing. And so it was. And that's what they say, that everything travels, but goodwill travels, though it mistravels, though, but it travels actually, and what it was. And tomorrow, the masterclass would be on the Court Fees Act and Suit Valuation Act. This is by S. Srivastava, Senior Advocate, Karnataka High Court. He's also writing a book and a revised version of this thing. His book is already a huge success. So do stay connected with us tomorrow at 4 p.m. Everyone stay safe, stay blessed. And we are also thankful to the team of Adilakshmi Logamoothi. Because of her, I can say that people log in more. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe.
Thank you.
Stay blessed.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.